we were talking to Gavin the other day, a few days ago, and he quoted, I think he was quoting somebody, but he said that if you were not a movie star, if you hadn't done Rich Man Poor Man, actually, that you'd be doing dinner theater somewhere still, because you're basically an actor. There's no question.
That's basically the truth. I mean, where I found home, you know, comfort, was on the stage. When I hit the stage, even though it was the most terrifying experience in my life, opening night, you say to yourself, why would you do this to yourself? Why would you make yourself even throw up, you know, and go out there and die in front of 1,000 people? Why would you do this to you? You know, that's what you say to yourself before you go on. And then you're so freaked out that you don't remember opening night. Hmm. You don't remember a thing, you know. Evidently, the play went well. They applauded at the end. You remember a little bit of that. But you can't remember a thing of opening night. Hmm. You know, and that happens for a few nights, you know, until you really start to get down into the play. But opening night is terrifying, you know. Even though there's that, there's this other thing that is just goes into your bones. You say, that's where I belong. This is where I belong.
So how old were you when you felt this the first time?
I was probably about 21 when that sunk in, you know.
Because your movie career didn't really start till you were like 30.
No, it doesn't start. There are some movies in there that people don't know about, but there used to be a casting director that would come through the Phoenix area. And I did a lot of repertory theater in Phoenix, in new companies that would start up. Actors Inner Circle, Southwest Ensemble Theater. Mm. You know, surprisingly, Phoenix is a kind of a way station of actors that didn't quite make it in LA, and then now they're moving back towards New York, you know. And that's the way this country is, you know. Mm. There's a lot of good theater along the way in Denver, a little place, Greeley, Colorado. Mm-hmm. There's the old Log Theater in Excelsior, Minnesota. Huh. It's been there longer than the Guthrie, you know, and all that kind of stuff. But it's, you know, but there's a whole circuit out there. Mm-hmm. If you sit down and organize it, you can find out where the big repertory companies are. Mm-hmm. Like the Dallas repertory companies, and then there's the Guthrie. Then there's Bill Ball up at, I don't know what they call it, something, but Bill Ball, he wears a cape, and he's rather flamboyant, and he always has one of his young lovers walk through the middle of a Shakespearean play, not connected to the play at all. All of a sudden, this young man comes walking through the play, you know, everybody stops and looks around, what has he got to do, and he walks off, you know. So then, that's just the way he is. And then there's Seattle rep. So you've got those rep companies. Then you've got a whole slug of guest artist theaters. Mm-hmm. These are connected with the university. And so they'll say, okay, come up for a stock, do 8 plays this year. Mm-hmm. You can pick two for yourself. You know, and I'd pick Luther, John Osborne's Luther, mm-hmm. because it went from a young man to an old man. Mm-hmm. And at first I could get the young man, you know. Mm-hmm. He's very passionate. He has these pulpit speeches that it goes down and he makes, and he's always talking about being constipated, and, you know, and the metaphor of this constipation is when he finally lets loose, mm-hmm. it causes all hell. You know, enough so that the Catholic Church offers him his own church, mm-hmm. Lutheranism, you know. And they ask him not to side with the peasants, right, in the peasant war. And he didn't, and 1 million peasants got slaughtered. So that's what he's discussing as an old man, you know. And then he gets riled about something the Catholic Church is doing. And so my old man says, now, Luther, the last time 1 million people were killed. Yeah, Osborne does a real good job, Luther.
Sometimes I think Osborne should be brought, it's like time for Osborne again.
Yeah.
Like we haven't seen Osborne on stage a lot in the last 20, 30 years, and now it's like He seems to feel like the moment. I don't know.
Yeah. I was talking to Christopher Plummer. Mm. You know, Zadie Christopher is. You know, I forgot this, but I replaced Christopher Plummer on Clean. I mean, a French film, Clean, with Maggie Cheung.
The Essayist movie, huh?
Yeah, the Essayist movie. And I think it was Christopher Plummer. They said he was sick. Mm-hmm. Said he was dying, in fact. Mm. And I saw him the other day. I didn't want to tell him that, you know. So, my God, you didn't die, you know. But we were talking about, I said, have you seen Finney? He said, no, I haven't seen him a couple of years. I said, but I'm not worried about Finney so much. I'm worried about the Scotsman. I mean, I said, oh, you mean the Below? He said, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think he's, you know. Mm. But that's what you do after you turn 70. You don't think about sex anymore, you know.
Think about mortality.
You know, what they say is about every 10 seconds you have a sexual thought. Mm-hmm. Well, after 70, every 10 seconds you have a dying thought, you know. So that's when you know the jig is up.
And Finney just signed for the Bond movie, so I guess he's doing okay.
Okay, well, then Finney's fine. Finney is fine. I just haven't talked to him for a long time. We did about three films there together. So we had a prenuptial, it's a crazy world.
So when you came to town, to L.A., mm-hmm. you did a lot of television, did a lot of episodics.
Yeah. Well, I came in because William Inge had seen me in this play in Phoenix. And Inge just flipped over it. So he said he was going to take this company to L.A. Huh. And he found at this Contempo furniture store across from UCLA. It had an old stage in it, an old proscenium, but we didn't use that. And he convinced that furniture store to allow us to put this play on. It was called The Last Pad. And IFA at the time, it's now ICM, but it was IFA. He was with them. They tried to cast it out from under him with some television stars. And he got real upset and fired them all. And I didn't know him well, you know. I'd talked to him several times after a performance and the fact that he wanted it to go to L.A. He would not go to New York. He said, I have been just abused in New York. He said, look what they did to Hal and Picnic. Mm-hmm. They put him in motorcycle boots and rolled up shirt with cigarettes. I mean, I've never seen a kid from Kansas like that. Mm-hmm. Maybe Brooklyn, but not Kansas. So he was very upset. And Arthur Miller was rather upset too. He struggled to get his place on Broadway. Of course, Tennessee was the darling of the whole deal. And Tennessee, I knew him. He was a very funny guy. Because Tennessee would sit in rehearsals, you know, and he'd get bored eventually, and he'd leave. Hmm. And he'd come back a couple of days later, and he'd be beat up, you know. Hmm. He'd have a scuff over here, and a kind of a little cut here, and bloody nose, and stuff. And he'd say, Tennessee, what happened to you? And Tennessee would say, he wouldn't put. Okay. I don't want to know what he wouldn't put me.
So did you work with him in New York or L.A. or
I was working
Phoenix?
With John Hancock, you know, in Chicago, mm-hmm. you know. Huh. You know, and I just knew him a little bit. You know? But Arthur, I got to know well because, well, first of all, there's an extended one act of Arthur's called Some Kind of Love Story, something like that. Mm-hmm. It's truly the piece of work on Marilyn, you know. But it happens in a small town in Connecticut, a mid-sized town, you know, and this woman has had interactions with the governor, the mayor, and the bad guy of the town, and all this. And there's a young kid that's going up for murder, and she knows it's a frame-up. Mm-hmm. So she hires a detective to get this information out of her, but she only wants to get out enough information to get the kid free and not get into the rest because it will kill her. She will be killed. She knows that. as Maryland was. Mm-hmm. And we tried to make it as a movie. I forget the name of it. It was with Deborah Winger, Carol Rice. Everybody wins.
Yeah.
Everybody wins.
Yeah.
And, you know, we knew what we were playing with. But Deborah had a difficult time with the role. It's probably the greatest role for a woman that's around. Mm-hmm. I mean, she literally has to change character right in front of you. You know, she goes into about five different characters. Mm-hmm. She goes into a little girl, the whore, then holier than thou, and the detective has had an affair with her by now, and he's talking to a psychiatrist on phone, you know, what she at, where she at now. Oh, she's over in the corner huddling, you know. Mm-hmm. He'd get her right up to the edge of the truth where she's gonna name names and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then she would flip characters on him. And it's a great play, but Arthur talked a little about Inge, and Inge got it the worst of all of them. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, he just, he had just a few of these great pieces, you know, mm-hmm. not as many as I think as Arthur or Tennessee. And so in the last pad, what he does is he takes his young man, mm-hmm. young lead, and they're all in prison for murder, and he's dying tonight. Mm-hmm. And then over in this cell, this homosexual, he's going to die in a week. Mm-hmm. And then the old philosopher in the back is going to die in a month. So what he's doing is killing all of his characters off. Mm-hmm. And that's fascinating enough. And then Bill committed suicide two nights before we opened the play, which, you know, was a tragic thing. We didn't know him really well, but what happened was it brought Time magazine down. It brought everybody down, and we had no idea that, you know, on that scale.
Right.
I mean, we were just theater bums, you know, you know. And man, they were asking us questions that were way out of our capability. So I just locked my dressing room and stayed in there, you know. And you know, with the first week, we had Elizabeth Taylor showed up, Sidney Poitier. I mean, they came like droves. And the play was really powerful. It was powerful. We had been running it for a year. Huh. So I actually got so I could throw up automatically, you know. It wasn't pretty, you know, but I just could up, chuck, boom.
So you didn't come to Hollywood looking for Hollywood?
No. Didn't. No. There was one time I had my hands down on my pants, you know, because the kid was dying, so I had a lot of gestures, and I didn't realize, but I had pulled my pecker out of my pants, and it was sitting on my stomach. I mean, I was like, oh, shit. Even though nobody's supposed to be seeing these cells, you know. And then there's Pat McFadden, who was the art director at the Met Theater. He kept coming down night after night saying, look, you got to read for Picnic. You got to do Picnic, you know. I don't know if I'm going to stay around. I'm going to get back out of town. Mm-hmm. And finally, at the very last minute, he said, look, I'm going to drive you to the theater, and you just read for it. So he just drove me there, and I read. And Jimmy Gammon said, you got the role. And I heard the stage door slam. That was the other actor going out. Just lost the role.
So Gammon was directing?
Yeah.
So was that what he was doing before he became an actor? Was that his?
Yeah, yeah, he was
director. I didn't know that about him.
Yeah, and he had started the Met Theater, yeah. Yeah, and then he became the screenwriter, Shepard's main guy. And then we got to do Sam's with Jimmy. He's dead now. But we got to do Sam's last play, Late Henry Moss, which is the last play of all of those plays of the two brothers and the drunken father and the outsider and all that. He brings it all on stage into a big mishmash of craziness, you know. And it was with Sean, you know, Penn and Woody Harrison and Cheech Marino, and it was a hell of a cast.
So when you were 30-something and you became a star all of a sudden in Richmond Foreman, well, was that happy or was that frustrating or was it distracting?
Yeah, you know, I appeared, I showed up and, well, I had this play. Like, I had an invitation, so I had a reason to come down. Mm-hmm. That's the best way to come in. You're going to do that? You're going to make all that noise? Huh? I was 34, mm-hmm. you know. When I auditioned for Rich Man Poor Man, I was 34, mm-hmm. and Peter was 22. Hmm. He was just graduated from Northwestern, huh. you know. And after our screen test, I said to him, I'll see you when we start shooting. He said, you don't know that. I said, yes, I do. I'll see you when we start shooting. He said, you don't know that. And I said, yes, I do. And it just happened. I did. I don't know why, but it just did, you know.
So did you like it? Was it work? Was it something else to do?
Was it... No, it was a ball. I had a ball. I mean, you know, I was able to take that role. The difficulty I had was at 34, we had to start at 16.
Right.
So I knew there wasn't any way to get there mentally. You know, there wasn't mm-hmm. anything that I could do there. I didn't want to try to talk like a young boy or anything mm-hmm. like that. So I just picked one quality of youth, which was to react, immediately react, mm-hmm. not do any thinking about, you know, just react. Mm-hmm. And then I ran around the Hollywood Reservoir so many times mm-hmm. to get down to what I weighed when I was in high school, which was 150 pounds. And I made it, I looked like I was a boy, you know. And then I just would fire off at anything was said, and finally nailed my old man into the bakery. Now, Ed Asner, who was great in it, mm-hmm. you know, but he doesn't think there was a Rich Man Poor Man because he was doing something very special for certain reasons. Mm-hmm. This is strange to talk to him mm-hmm. because he'd never watched it after his role mm-hmm. because he was doing just something very special, he says, you know. And he was, in a way, but so it's just weird, you know. I said, well, you know, we went on and had a good time, and, mm-hmm. you know, it was one of, my death was announced on Congress, and he said, yeah, well, I didn't see it. You know, I had something very special to do. That's what I did, and so, you know, I just kind of leave it at that. You know? And then, off of the play, uh-huh. the casting directors would come, and then they'd say, do you have any footage on you? Mm-hmm. Which I did have footage, but, you know, I didn't really want to tell them about the riot, you know,
right.
being an extra in a scene or Electra Gliding Blue, you know. Hmm. I provided all the motorcycles for that. Huh. I was living in a kind of a commune in Phoenix, you know. Hmm. And there was a Walt Disney thing called the Feather Farm. You know, there was this casting director who'd come down and he'd watch the plays and then he'd say, well, you know, I got this role or this role and this role. And so I'd pick up roles there. Hmm. But there wasn't anything that would propel anyone
right.
in anything. I mean, the Feather Farm, I was playing a cowboy and that comes up on a lady that owns a ranch and she's raising ostriches. Mm-hmm. And so my sidekick was the art director, or the director of mm-hmm. the repertory theater we were in, Mel Weiser, who was a small guy. So he got to ride the ostrich, you know. And we had this shot where from way out there, uh-huh. the horses, a herd of horses, and me herding the horses, mm-hmm. we had to come right up to the ranch and into the corral. Mm-hmm. And then it was a herd of horses, me, the ostriches, mm-hmm. and then Mel on an ostrich. We shot that once a week for about a month.
Really?
You know, yeah. We'd get the horses there, easy. And I would get there. But the ostriches would go that way, and Mel's ostrich would sit down on them, you know. And then you have to choke them back. You have this little broom. And you're right in the ostrich, and you want the ostrich to go that way. You take the broom, flash it on its eye over here, you know, and they're bivocular, or whatever it's called. This eye sees out this way, and this one sees this way. So if someone comes here, it's got to go that way. So it'll go that way, and then you go over this side, and it'll go that way. But if you give it too quick, this and this, it just shuts down. He sits down. Mm. Now, in order to get him back up, usually you got to get off and let him get his feet under him and then hop back on him. But the way you stop him is reach the broom around their neck and choke them back. It looks brutal.
You could have an ostrich wrangler if this had not worked out.
Yeah. Well, I had to do an ostrich mating dance. It's one of those things that if you had a lot of friends, you'd give them tomatoes and things and you'd screen it. And Newman would do that, you know. He'd do a bad movie and he'd invite all his friends and give them tomatoes and stuff to throw at the screen.
So the takeaway from Rich Man seemed to be that you were a pretty boy, though, that you were like the new
handsome. Well, yeah, that's the thing. Well,
was that a conflict with your acting, with your
seriousness? Well, yeah, sure, it is going to be a conflict because I'm not 22. You know, I'm 34, and I've got 13 years of theater chasing novelists, you know, chasing playwrights. And I didn't care about the arena, you know. Mm-hmm. I wasn't an arena guy. I didn't want to go to New York and carry Spears, hoping to get a part on Broadway, mm-hmm. or go to L.A. and study and hope to get something else.
Right.
You know, I wanted to do the work I needed to do now, or there's mm-hmm. no sense doing it, you know. What's the fun of it, you know? But that meant then you can't be concerned about the arena. You know, if it's in Minnesota, you go to Minnesota, mm-hmm. you know, and then that you get to do the plays you want to do. I right off the get-go, I had a tough time. You know, first of all, as Rich Man, Poor Man went along, I heard these kind of conversations. You know, if this works, we'll do Roots next. You know, the book Roots. Yeah, that's great. And, you know, and then I heard this conversation. You know, instead of 3 2-hour movies, we should cut this up into half hours and stretch it out, because it's awful good stuff. And, of course, that was going against the grain of everything they told me, mm-hmm. you know. So I called a meeting, you know, and I said, what's this about that we're not going to do 3 2-hour movies now? Mm-hmm. We're going to cut them half hours. Yeah, that's right. We're going to cut them half hours. She goes, well, that's not what you pitched us on. You know, we all thought we were doing 2-hour movies. Yeah, but this is really right. And believe me, we know you don't, you know. And okay, all right. And we wanted to talk to you anyway, Nick, about the who you would play in the second Rich Man Poor Man. Mm. The second Rich Man Poor Man? You mean Irwin Shaw is going to write another book? Well, no, I don't think he's going to write another book. Well, then who would write? We did some television writers. Well, it was Frank Price. I said, well, Frank, who would I play? You know, I die in this. He said, well, you could come back as your son. And I'm going, you know, I don't think that works. Mm-hmm. I really don't think it works. Well, $1 million would make it work. And I said, no. Wouldn't even come close, you know. And my manager is going, no, I'm going to play the devil's advocate. You know, when your manager says that, she ain't on your side no more, you know. She wants some money, you know. So I just...
$1 million, big money back then.
Oh, yeah.
Big money, yeah.
Big money. I mean, I had several people get upset with turning down $1 million on the Fort Apache. Mm-hmm. I forget who it was making that. Some journalist, I thought. Mm-hmm. But he put it right in an article. He said, who is Nick Nolte think he is to turn down $1 million? Well, Fort Apache, when he sent it to me, it was 300 pages long. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I had only spent a few weeks in New York my whole lifetime, let alone play at New York Cop at that time, you know. So I didn't do it. Paul Newman ended up doing it, you know.
And,
it
was a and Ed Asner did something special.
Yeah, I think so, you know.
So when you did The Deep, you did it for Yates or you did it for...
Well, no, I turned it down. I turned it down and I turned it down and I turned it down. And Frank Price finally said to me, you know, until you finish your obligation to television, Universal, you will not work films. And so Ned Tanum called me and Ned said, Nick, how about let's make it a little three-picture deal. Mm-hmm. And I said, you mean at Universal? Then, yeah, where else? You know, you just did a hell of a job for us. I said, well, geez, Ned, I'm sorry, I can't work for you. He said, what do you mean you can't work for me? Well, Frank told me until I finish my obligation in television, I can't work film at Universal. He said, oh, you don't believe that shit, do you? I said, yeah, I take the man for his word, you know. Said, he laughed, and he said, well, we'll talk later, you know. And all I could get were these three-picture deals. They wouldn't name a picture or anything. And there was Apocalypse Now out there. Mm-hmm. So I went up for that, which Coppola just sent me not long ago, the auditions, you know. And you just see a little bit of Tommy Lee, they're really interesting. Mm-hmm. They're really interesting to see that stuff.
Were you good?
Yeah, I was good. It would have been an entirely different guy going up the river than... and Martin Sheen. There wasn't much military about me, you know. There was Slapshot. Mm-hmm. So I started skating, even though I grew up in Iowa. We didn't skate.
Was the Unkeen role or the Paul Newman role?
Yeah, Unkeen role. And I hung out with Ned Dowd, who Nancy Dowd wrote it, and Ned played for the St. Louis Blues, the St. Louis Blues. Hockey club, and I got pretty good. You know, I could go forward, backwards, but as soon as you threw a puck on the ice, bloom, I was gone. So, George Ray Hill said, you got 2 months to try and get this, you know, and I worked my ass off, George Ray said, you know, Nick, I could do it with you, but I'd have to do it like Love Story, you know. Shoot it like this, and you'd pretend. And I said, Joey, you can't do that. And he said, no, I can't. He said, I'm going to have to go with Anki. I said, well, that's fine. So I got close there, and I was talking to Billy Friedkin about the saucer. But he had that already set up with that actor.
Roy Sutton?
Yeah. And those were the three films that I was interested in. And I went after him. I got a call from Talia Shire the night before they were going to announce who was in Apocalypse. And she said, as of right now, Nick, you have it. But then something happened over that night that they announced the next morning, Harvey Keitel. And then Harvey did his usual number. He didn't get to him for about a month. And so he left the picture, you know. And so then Martin Sheen came in.
So is Harvey in the talking about Mortality Family with you guys now? Is it?
Well, I just know that Harvey was on a Kubrick film, and Kubrick didn't use him for a few weeks, and he walked away. So I guess that's what he does. Speaking of Kubrick, one of the greatest stories is, which I loved the film, was the one with Ryan O'Neill.
Barry Lyndon.
Yeah, Barry Lyndon. I mean, it was an amazing film of a young man growing up in that society, going through it and all that. And he had shot everything he could with because he loses his leg.
Right.
So he shot everything he could except the part where his leg was lost. And he called Ryan O'Neill in and he said, Ryan, you know, I've tried everything. I've tied up the leg. We've tried even one-legged guy, but it doesn't have a look like you. You know, it's just a dilemma. he said, but there is a way out of it, and it's really simple, and it's all arranged. You know, there's an ambulance waiting, and they'll just take you over, and it's only 15 minutes, and it'd be all fine. And he just got about a few weeks of, 3 or 4 weeks of a little bit of rehab, you know, and we'd be on our way. And Brian said, you want me to cut my leg off? And he said, yeah, would you do that? No, I'm not going to do that. But I mean, you know, things can happen. There's another one, about true back that knocks me out. This one, Altman was telling me about this. It was the guy's talking about fluoride.
About the
The actor. You know, he
can win.
Who
in Strangelove?
No, Strangelove. Yeah, he's talking about fluoride. They put fluoride into the toothpaste. What was the name?
Holloway. Sterling, not
Sterling.
Sterling.
Hayden.
Hayden, yeah.
Hey, Sterling. That's right. Sterling, you know, Sterling was a Mississippi barge driver when he was a kid. And I lived on the Mississippi, so I knew those kind of guys. They were really tough guys, you know. They'd go around and lift shit out of the river all day. And I was up at one of Minnesota. His name was, I can't think of his name. Those were the Bogart brothers, those guys. But so Sterling, he was watching rehearsals, and he went to Kramer. He said, I'm no good. I can't do this. These are great actors. I mean, Jesus, Peter Sellers, what he's doing, and George C. Scott. My God, I can't do this. I can't. I can't possibly do what they're doing. I'm not in their class. You just got to let go of me. And Kubrick said, paranoid, are you? He said, oh, hell yes, I'm paranoid. He said, good, stay that way. And that was it.
That's good direction for that character.
Good, stay that way. Yeah.